I'm Senator Kemp Hannon, legislative report. If you follow legislative matters a great deal, you may have heard the phrase UB 2020 and wondered, what in Lord's name is it? Well, UB 2020, which started out for SUNY, University of Buffalo, modernization, empowerment, change in how we look at our one of our four major academic centers for the State University of New York, SUNY, has begun a whole debate, two-year-long debate, and trying to shed some enlightenment on a very important debate, really not just about the four academic centers of the state, which are Stony Brook and Albany and Binghamton and Buffalo, but all the rest of the SUNY system, is Elaine Crosson, who has joined us today. She is the general counsel of LIU, moved to Stony Brook as Vice President for External Affairs.
That's correct.
Well-versed in all things academic, higher academics. You come at this as a lawyer. You've been at the Court of Appeals. And you've mastered this whole topic. So there are lots of different elements to it. It's modernization of how the governance goes for how our major academic centers are treated. It's tuition, which has the wonderful catchphrase, rationalization of tuition. Having just finished being a parent of two going through college, they graduated just this week. There's no rationalization of tuition as far as I'm concerned, but these are the different proposals that are on the table and very important for the future of education, higher education in this state. And maybe you can give me a little bit of a sales pitch on this and all that.
Sure, I'd be happy to, and thanks for having me. Well, this year, the UB 2020 proposal was expanded to include the four university centers, which you named as Albany, Binghamton, Buffalo, and Stony Brook. And what the governor and the chancellor have proposed is to use these academic institutions, the major research institutions in the state, as a catalyst for economic growth in the state. It's a model that's been used in other states like Michigan and California, and Governor Cuomo and Chancellor Zimpfer have really put this proposal together based on those models. And the SUNY 2020 proposal, as it reads now, has two major components. The first is the governor has identified $35 million in capital construction funds that would go to each of the four university centers, for a total of $140 million statewide. The challenge to the campuses is to identify a capital project that would be tied to economic growth. And the other challenge is to match the $35 million with enough to complete a building that would house researchers and scientists that would create that economic growth. So at Stony Brook, we've identified a capital project that would focus on medical research, and I'll get back to that in a moment. But the other component is to increase our operating budgets by increasing tuition. Over the past 3 years, SUNY's budget at Stony Brook has been cut $75 million, and our tuition has remained stagnant. So that's resulted in layoffs of faculty and other staff members, and the governor has challenged us to come up with a plan that says, if you raise your tuition, how can you spur economic growth on Long Island?
And that very question about raising tuition has sparked some opposition with my colleagues in the legislature who feel they don't want to do that.
Absolutely, and that's understandable, but they have to understand the full parameters of our plan. Our plan is not only focused on economic growth on Long Island, and we have a plan that would create 8,000 plus jobs on Long Island.
That's pretty enticing. That's a pretty big carrot.
And they're high-paying jobs as well. And as you know, as a Long Islander, you have to have a high-paying job to live in a high-cost area like Long Island. So we came up with a plan that we believe not only encourages economic growth, but increases access to our student population. You know, you might be surprised to learn that Stony Brook has one of the poorer student populations in the SUNY system. We draw a lot from the urban area of New York City. So, for example, 45% of our student population are TAP eligible, which means they come from families with incomes of $60,000 or less.
And that's really a sense, you're saying that in the sense of fulfilling the mission of SUNY, which was to serve the range of income in New York State.
Absolutely, and at Stony Brook, because of our population, we are very committed to retaining access to a quality education like you can get at Stony Brook right now. So
you have very high academic achievements for your entering class in terms of the Scholastic Aptitude Test and the grade point averages that come out of high school. I mean, it's very tough.
I mean,
for the people who write and say, can you give a recommendation, Senator Hannon? People are really fighting to get in.
Yes, we're very proud that our academic standing has increased over the years. And, you know, it is a very competitive school. But getting back to the access issue, I just want to point out that our plan, because we would raise tuition under this plan, it was very important for us to protect access for that key group of students whose parents earn $60,000 or less. So we have pledged in our plan to take a full 35% of the increased operating revenue generated by the tuition increase, set it aside, and use it for needs-based institutional scholarships so that the students who come from families earning less than $75,000 would be fully protected dollar for dollar from this tuition increase. In other words, they would not pay a penny more than the current tuition because we will protect them.
And for how long would that be?
Well, the plan we were asked to submit was a 7-year plan, and we're committed to setting aside the 35% for 7 years.
Now, the debate is don't raise tuition, and then you go back and look at the history of SUNY, and we've had these plateaus. You go for 6, 7, 8 years, no tuition hike. And all of a sudden, we'd get into a cash crunch in the state, and they'd have to raise tuition. So it would jump up. If it were rationalized, I guess that's the whole thing, and a couple of percentage points every year, it would be about the same, and it would be more predictable. Because if you're in school when that jump occurs, you're really out of luck, because you may not be able to afford continuing.
That's correct, and that's exactly what's happened with SUNY in recent years. When the state runs into a fiscal problem, which is usually tied to a recession, state funding for SUNY goes down, so the need to increase tuition goes up. It's at a time when folks can least afford it, and as you said, it's totally irrational. You could go to SUNY for 4 years and have no tuition increase. You could go to SUNY and get your tuition increased every year substantially if you have the misfortune of going to college during an economic downturn.
One of those things. What's the tuition right now at Stony Brook?
The tuition is under $5,000 a year. It's one of the lowest tuitions in the country. And even if we were to get the tuition increase proposed under SUNY 2020, we would still be among the lowest in the country, particularly among AAU institutions, which are the elite class of research institutions. Stony Brook is a member of that organization, and even with the tuition increase proposed, we would still be one of the lowest tuitions.
You've piqued my interest now, because you said research, and let's go back to what you're talking about as a building, but I would also like you to mention towards the end of that, I just saw a picture of an energy institute or something also that's already up that you've had from private donation. There's some exciting things taking place.
There is. And, you know, SUNY has Stony Brook has two new buildings. One is a center of excellence for wireless and information technology, and the other is an advanced energy center. And they are both relatively new buildings, and there's all kinds of innovation and technology. I'll have you out there one time. Underway there, our researchers are working away. And there's room in both of those facilities for some of the new hires we'd like to make under SUNY 2020.
And these are not little buildings.
No, these are substantial buildings built in part with some state funding. And we are going to be having some private companies join us in those buildings under a public-private partnership that's called for under SUNY 2020. Right now you have to go to the legislature and get special permission to do that. Under SUNY 2020 it would become more routine that you would be able to do that. And it makes for a great partnership with private industry.
And the precedent is Senator Fischello just saw passage of legislation to allow precisely that at Farmingdale, the four-year college in Farmingdale, SUNY Farmingdale, and to allow OSI to have, and hopefully that's a keeping jobs, building jobs, so you have the same blueprint.
Absolutely, we have the same blueprint, and it would allow companies that are struggling otherwise, like OSI was, to stay on Long Island, keep those high-paying jobs on Long Island, and that's what we should all be working towards. So the SUNY 2020 initiative is very well-timed.
Now tell me about the medical research that you want to do with the governor's matching money. In fact, you're going to raise a lot more than just match his money.
That's right. The governor has pledged $35 million. We have identified $160 million. So the building is about a $195 million building, and it will house medical research in a translational setting. And what that means is the scientists and the physicians work side by side in the same building. And the idea is to move the innovation and the scientific research to product more quickly because of the practical application of working right next to a physician.
So you're going to be doing this at the same time that North Shore LIJ has just expanded its research. Winthrop's talking about expanding its and building a research building. Cold Spring Harbor is doing it, and you already are intensively involved between the hospital and then your academic departments.
Correct, and we partner with Brookhaven National Lab, and the only national lab on Long Island, and we're the only SUNY institution who partners with a national lab. So some Brookhaven scientists will be joining us in our medical research building. And it's very exciting, and it also dovetails with the governor's initiative on Accelerate Long Island, which calls for a partnership among all of the institutions you just named.
Well, that was partially. I think I've been at a couple of the preliminary meetings, and it was president of Stony Brook, president of Brookhaven, but also a fellow who's renowned as a philanthropist to Stony Brook is James Simon, who's is a professor, I guess ex-professor, but went and founded a hedge fund.
Yes.
And he's been very generous in turning the money back and then leading the way.
It's
interesting what a carrot that is.
He's a very generous donor to both Stony Brook and to Brookhaven National Lab over the years. He's a brilliant mathematician who still teaches at Stony Brook. Yes, we're lucky to have him.
Well, the whole thing will be, we're never going to get into an era where we have aerospace manufacturers on Long Island. I mean, that has gone. So that what we have to do is look at high tech, maybe biotech, medical engineering, software, and see where we can move forward, because we need the jobs.
Absolutely, and that's what this plan is all about.
So what is the catchphrase of the plan?
SUNY 2020.
2020. So if we get there by 2020, and we'll have more jobs.
2020 vision.
We're holding. Elaine Crosson, thank you very much for joining with us. Senator Kemp Hannon, have a good day.